Welcome back. Our guest is Coach John Thompson Jr. He was the coach of the men's basketball team at Georgetown University from 1972 to 1999, where he remains coach emeritus. His son, John Thompson III, is now the coach of that men's basketball team. He says they're both fakes. The real John Thompson is his late father, the original John Thompson. Speaking of fathers, we got an email here from Pierre who says, please ask Coach Thompson how he feels about the AAU and the direction that youth basketball is taking. I think it's a pretty good question since you had the show about the book Play Their Hearts Out by George Dorman. He probably hates AAU coaches because the bad ones like Joe Keller make us all look horrible. They also think that AAU coaches tell their players where to go to college. It might upset him, so be careful. Let him know there are good ones, like me, who pay tutors out of their own pockets and make their players attend mandatory study halls from the third grade and up. Weekly study halls before, during, and after season. I also have weekly communication with the problem students' teachers to find out what the tutor should focus on that week. Let him know there are good ones who don't want money or fame for their players. Pierre happens to be my son, who lives in Florida, who is an AAU coach.
Well, you know, first of all, I try hard, and I guess I'm guilty of it at times, of not generalizing. You know, I think that there's some terrible AAU coaches, and there are some guys who I'm certain are very good, but I'm going to tell you what my problem is. And I mentioned this, and I told you I had a meeting with the president of the NCAA, and one of the things that I told him is that they took all of the power away from the college coaches. They took power, the high school federation took power from the high school coaches. Those were people, Kojo, that they had accountability over. And they empowered the AAU people who have no accountability from anybody. So we were so concerned about college coaches cheating and high school coaches spending so much time, but we had people who could hold them accountable. They had federations, they had the NCAA, but by saying now you can't spend time with the kids, we empowered people who have nobody holding them accountable. Certainly they're great AAU coaches, but I'm going to tell you this, all of us need to have checks and balances in our lives, including John Thompson, to question what you're doing and how you're doing it. I think the NCAA created the problem with the AAU coaches. I think the High School Federation did it by limiting the people who they could hold accountable and empowering a bunch of people who nobody holds accountable. So that's my problem. Certainly there are good people and there are bad people involved, but there are a hell of a lot of bad ones too because they understand how to market these young kids' talents. Now, Kojo, when you go to talk to a kid now, very seldom does a college coach even talk to a high school coach. The people who are running the lives of these young people now are AAU coaches. And as a result of that, they have a lot of leverage against institutions, against shoe contracts, against a lot of things right now. I just hope that there's something that can hold them accountable and have checks and balances, but certainly they're good ones too.
Does that work for you, Pierre?
That worked very well for me. Thank you, Dad. Thank you, Coach Thompson.
All right. Welcome. Thanks a lot for your call and for your email. We move on now to Ed in Berryville, Virginia. Ed, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Mr. Thompson. I want to thank you for everything that you've done and continue to do.
Thank you.
We used to go to junior high school together at East Providence Junior High School when you were a student teacher for PC and I was just a regular student.
No, good for you. No, I tell people about Mrs. Samuelson was my teacher who supervised my student teaching at that school.
I thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ed, thank you very much for your call. Is there anything else you wanted to say? Ed, are you there?
No, I'm still here, yes.
Oh, is there anything else you wanted to say?
No, he's a great man. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your call. You talked about when you had a learning disability when you were young in school, and that's one of the things that I thought caused you and Patrick Ewing to get close, because Patrick Ewing, it's my understanding, also had a learning disability when he was younger, but you never had any doubt in your mind about whether he and others would be able to matriculate at Georgetown University.
Well, our opportunity is what I fight for. See, we don't operate on a level playing field. You know, historically, we can go back and notice something occurred in this country, and I don't want to belabor it, that put people at a disadvantage. So now we start testing folks who've been put at a disadvantage, and then after we start testing them, we start labeling them. And the only thing that I'm saying and that I said at that point in time is that if you get enough information from the people who've worked with them, if you get enough information from interviewing them, then provide them with an opportunity to fail. If they don't do what they're supposed to do, if I took a chance on a kid, I would tell whoever was involved in helping me give them a chance that I will correct it if they don't do what they're supposed to do. You don't have to worry about it. I will get them out of here. Because as I told the kids, if you want to be a slave, I do not want to be the master. So let's understand one thing. We want to play. We want to win. That's very significant because that gives you leverage to walk out on Proposition 42. That gives you leverage to question why they aren't African Americans refereeing or African Americans coaching. If you win, people listen to you. If you lose, they say it's sour grapes. Okay? But if the opportunity comes for these kids, then they better take advantage of that opportunity, or I'm going to tell you that you got to get out of here.
How do you feel about the characterization that you were a father figure for some of those kids? Indeed, some people think that you are a father figure for them even after they become adults.
Well,
Allen Iverson started getting into trouble. People started saying, well, why doesn't John Thompson speak to him? And you pointed out, Allen Iverson is a 35-year-old man.
Right, and I do speak to him. This is what happens. Folks think, first of all, that the only people that you talk to are your prominent players. You know, the only people you have a relationship with. And I've been accused of that by former players either.
Sure.
Okay, but listen to me. They are the only people that people are interested in hearing about. Mm-hmm. In other words, if I talk to Lonnie Duren down at Sursum Quarter, who I talk to more than any former player I've ever had, who the hell cares? They don't know who he is.
Right.
If I talk to Patrick Ewing and it leaks out, everybody talks about it. If I talk to Allen Iverson, everybody talks about it. And at this point in my life, I want the players to talk to me. I don't want to talk to them. But no, you hear people talking about the father figure thing. I have never embraced that. You know, because I think who a person's father is and who their parents are something very special and sacred to them. There's a lot of players that I coach that I hope I never see again in my life. I'm very serious about that now. Yeah. And people don't understand when I say that. But mm-hmm. there's a lot of them that I miss seeing, okay? Mm-hmm. Because you provide them while they're there with the opportunity to get an education. You work with them as hard as you can. But let's understand this, Kojo. Mm-hmm. The player has to take the responsibility for his own education. I resent that mentality that there's somebody there who's going to look after me. There's somebody that's going to take after me. I hope the hell I conveyed to the people who I coach that you are responsible for your education. I'm assisting you. Now, after the 4 years, baby, it's over because four more are coming in here that I've got to work with.
It was another one of your star players who ended up challenging your role as a mentor of young people. In the late 80s, you talked in a major TV interview with Ted Koppel about how you had the face-to-face meeting with Rafael Edmund, the well-known, notorious drug kingpin in the district, when you learned he was spending time with your star player, Alonzo Mourning, and with another player, John Turner, who apparently knew Edmund from growing up in D.C. What do you remember from your conversation with Rafael Edmund?
Too much to tell you.
I know how you probably talked to him, and we can't say that on the radio.
No, we had a visit with one another. But the great thing about that, and that's a perfect example of what I'm talking about, is that I wanted to win games. I did everything I could and everything I should and probably some things I shouldn't have done to win. But I knew that I had a responsibility also to teach. Alonzo at that time was a young man who was making a tremendous mistake. And his association with Rafael at the time. I had to visit with Rafael and talk with him about that. Anna taught me that. That's my mother. Whenever I got in trouble, my mother would take that apron off and deal with the problems that I had. So that's what I attempted to do. But look at Alonzo Mourning has a building named after him in Miami. Alonzo Mourning is helping people, people with kidney problems. It was worth it for every teacher at Georgetown who invested time in this man because now he is a special individual, and that's all I'm saying.
There was a moment 6 years ago.
You notice how I avoid talking about Rafael Edmund.
I noticed that. Rafael is still incarcerated. There was a moment 6 years ago when your son was coaching in his second season at Georgetown. They weren't ranked at the time, but they beat the number one team in the country, Duke, at home on national television in an arena in a part of town that resembled so little of what that part of town looked like just 20 years before. Throngs of people pouring out onto 7th Street to celebrate. D.C. Councilmember Jack Evans once said on this show that that game wasn't just a great moment for Georgetown basketball, but it was a great moment for this city. This is your city. What were you feeling when that happened?
Well, I felt great. You know, as a parent yourself, there's nothing more gratifying. I love my kids dearly. I have three of them and probably 100 others. And I probably abused them verbally growing up. But I am really, the greatest feeling of satisfaction is when you can look at your child and doing something and accomplishing something. I knew what it meant to him. When I'm not involved, it's worse than when I was involved. So when he accomplished that, and I knew it was extremely important for him, it made me feel good. But anytime my kids do things that are out of the public eye or in the public eye, it's very gratifying. I don't always let them know it, though.
You went away to play for Providence. You went away to play for the Boston Celtics. But in a way, you've always stayed home. What is it about Washington that keeps you here?
I don't know. I ask myself that. I love this area. I love this Maryland, Washington, Virginia area. And it's just, I was lucky that I was able to make a living and able to do my thing at home. And I like it here. I love it here. And I love the people who are here. And they have been very supportive of me most of the time. But I couldn't tell you why. I just like, this is...
And he's still working here. Only four jobs now that he's doing. John Thompson, Washingtonian.
And willing to take others.
He was the coach of the men's basketball team at Georgetown from 1972 to 1999, and now he has more time to join us on a more frequent basis. We'll be calling you.
Thanks. It's truly a pleasure to be here with you. I have enjoyed listening to you during my spare time. That's one of the things I do. I never told you that.
I appreciate
it. So I enjoyed it, and thanks so much.
Thank you all for listening. I'm Kojo Nandi.